I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to talk, as part of our Foundation of Mathematics series, about the greatest single discovery and innovation in the history of mathematics and science put together. It is the HinduArabic number system that are currently taught to students everywhere around the world. Let me remind you that our approach so far to numbers has been as a string of ones. So a natural number is just a string of ones, and it's a sequence that carries on endlessly like this. It becomes pretty clear when we're working with numbers this way that larger and larger numbers become awkward to deal with. And every civilization has had to innovate, find ways of shortening these large numbers. So we're going to talk today about a precursor to the Hindu-Arabic system, the Roman numeral system, and that's a natural stepping stone from this sort of primitive, basic understanding of numbers to the one we currently have. All right, so the idea, first of all, to go to the Roman system, and this is a simplified Roman system, not the full one that they use, is to introduce other symbols for larger denominations. Just as in commerce, we don't all want to run the economy using $1 bills. We also want $10 bills, and $100 bills, and $1,000 bills if necessary. So the Romans introduced new symbols for larger numbers of ones and larger number of other numbers. So the basic step is to take 10 ones, a string of 10 ones, and call it 10. Okay. And we denote that by the symbol X. Then we agree that if we have 10 X's, or 10 tens, that we denote that by the symbol C and call that 100. 10 hundreds, denoted by an M, called 1,000. And we can introduce further symbols if we want to. So now the idea is, instead of having a huge string of ones, we group those ones into tens, and then we group the tens into hundreds, and we group the hundreds into thousands, and so on. So we can write a number like this: 2 M's, 4 C's, 5 1's. That would be the number 2,405. In this case, there are no 10s in that number. And we agree that when we do this, that we're going to list the bigger denominations first, so thousands, hundreds, 10s, and then 1's, and that any 10 symbols of the same kind are replaced by a bigger symbol. So we're not allowed to have 10 or 11 or 12 C's in a row. We would then agree that we're going to replace 10 of those C's with an M, or any 10 X's are replaced by a C. So that means that effectively the maximum number of symbols that we have in a row in such an expression is 10 minus 1. This is the simplified Roman numeral system, which was in use for, of course, thousands of years. And it serves as a very good shortcut to our basic understanding of natural numbers. All right, so the Indian mathematicians introduced a couple of key innovations. What they did is they, first of all, had names and symbols for all of the numbers between what we call now 1 and 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We've already talked about those, but now we also have 6, 7, 8, and 9. And more important, we have these symbols to represent them. So these are just new symbols. They're somewhat arbitrary. Doesn't really matter which ones we use, but we agree to use these ones. And these symbols represent these strings of ones. In addition, we're also going to need to have a new symbol for nothing. So the new symbol called zero, denoted by a circle. That stands for nothing. And now the idea of the Hindu-Arabic number system is very simple. We take a natural number expressed in Roman form, like this, and what we do is we record the number of units of each size, starting from the right. So we record how many ones there are. In this case, there are 5 ones, so we write down a 5. Then we go to tens. How many tens are there? There are 0 tens in this case, so we write down a 0. There are 4 hundreds, we write down a 4. There are 2 thousands, we write down a 2. So this represents this Roman numeral, which of course represents a huge string of ones with 2,405 ones. So the key innovation here is first of all, that we are only using the numbers from 0 to 9 in each place, because there's at most 9 of any string allowed. If there were 10 or more, we would replace it with one of the next bigger up. And the second is that we're allowed to use 0 to hold the place, in other words, to record the number of denominations at that particular size. 0 tens in this case. That's very important, so we keep the ones, tens, hundreds, and thousands all straight. The Hindu-Arabic number system allows us to deal with large numbers very effectively. And one of the interesting innovations is that powers of 10 become important. So the first new symbol is this 10, which stands for 0 ones and 110. So that's our new symbol for the actual number 10, no longer an X. 100, which is 0 ones, 0 tens, and 100, is now represented by this expression, 100. And we also can write it as 10 times 10, or 10 squared. In the same way, we have 1,000 represented by 10 cubed, or 10 times 10 times 10. 10,000, 10 to the 4th. 100,000, 10 to the 5th. And 1,000,000, 10 to the 6th. And we could keep on going. So if we have a number like 327, what that is really, in terms of tens, is there are 7 ones, 2 tens, and 3 hundreds. So we can always rewrite a number like this if we need to as multiples of powers of 10. So what are the advantages of the Hindu-Arabic number system? Well, first of all, it's very compact. Secondly, it simplifies arithmetic dramatically. In ancient times, only very well-educated people could hope to do simple multiplications. And even most reasonably complicated multiplications could only be done approximately because of the cumbersome nature of the Roman and other systems. With Hindu-Arabic arithmetic, even young people in primary school can learn how to multiply biggish numbers by hand. And that's an important skill. It allows approximation in a very effective way. And we'll talk about that when we extend the Hindu-Arabic system to decimals. And this is a key point in the importance of this system for scientific work. So this is really a fabulous innovation. One can't overestimate how important this was to the modern world. Next time, we're going to talk about how arithmetic is transformed using this system. I hope you'll join me. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.